Hello, good morning again. So here we are, just you and me, another day in this year of walking, in this year of walking with the Lord. Good morning again. It's a good morning. It's a good morning. An interesting one. That thing that's trying me still hanging around, so bear with me if I and if I, if I do these things, it's my part of the game. It is what it is. So the thing on my mind this morning, right, is have you ever had a moment where you talk around, and especially if it's one of those conversations of who's the best, who's got the biggest one, and you walk in there all like arrogant, like you've had like a big event gut, and in a moment of that, somebody comes in and smacks you so hard that your fierce plat, man. One of the biggest places that your ego and your pride get hit so hard, so damaged, when you try and be all arrogant, like, "Well, check what I've done. Look what I did. Yeah, boy." And it's interesting how that happens. Pride is pride and ego and arrogance. One of the things that I've realized in life, if I'm a client to somebody, or somebody's approaching me from a sales perspective and they want to come sell something to me, even if I've been a client of these people for yonks, as soon as a salesperson is arrogant and he is prideful and he's like, "I'm the best, my stuff is the best, you will buy from me," I won't. There's nothing you can do that's going to make me accept you. I will actually change companies because of people like that. It's quite sad, really. And there's a very fine line between confidence and arrogance. There's a fine line. And the line shifts, I've realized, also in life. It depends on how much you understand of confidence. But there's a fine line, definitely, between the two. Why am I rambling on about this morning? It's because I found a key element a long time ago, actually, but God's pointing it out to me this morning. And it's something that really, that's what elevates us in life. It's what gets us exalted. It's what we are meant to do. And what is that one thing? It's definitely, in my opinion, I think it's a big thing for the Lord, because there's so much scripture on this one thing. And it's, as I said, it's a key component, a key element to being exalted, to being elevated, to be praised on other levels, and that's humility. Humility is a difficult thing for us humans to sometimes stick to, especially when praise starts coming in. I always say to people, one of my biggest, largest, humble keepers in life is my mom, funny enough. Boy, if my mom walks into a room and she hears me bragging on how cool and great and how lekker I am, or could be, or whatever, she'll say something in such an instance. And I'm thinking of a few moments now throughout my life where people would laugh their bums off, but there's a particular one or two moments that were so key for me in my life that made me get this part of humility. And I thank God for every time those moments come, because at the time you don't understand it. When you walk into a place in an office environment or in the work life or wherever, and you're all like duck, and somebody walks in and they slap you straight down, how ashamed they made you, or try hard on your mark sort of thing, they'll fall on their own as well. That's one thing I've realized in life, is those people will fall on their own. It's not my job to do it. I don't wish it on them either, because that's not characteristics of Jesus. It's not wishing bad stuff on other people. We don't do that. It's about us and where our heart is and how we are. And life is like that. They will try. People will try. If you stand for the Lord, you're a target. We know this. We know this already, and we should remember this at all times. So, why humility, though? The angle that God showed me this morning is that you is that because how can we brag about stuff that we didn't do, that you and I didn't do? How can we brag on things that we cannot achieve by ourselves? I mean, we couldn't even save ourselves. We needed Jesus to do that. We can't change ourselves. We change for the better when we truly live for God, seek God, and start applying His truths in our lives. We truly start changing for the better and for the best. It's such an interesting space, this morning. It's like, you know, it's because I know, for instance, in my life, it's purely because of God and what He's been doing in my life and how I'm seeking Him and how He's been changing me and growing me. It's only because of Him that I've been able to reach the space I'm at, moving into the direction I'm moving, do the things that I've done, achieve the things that I've achieved. I wouldn't even be here if it wasn't for Him. I would have been dead many, many years ago. I'm sure about that. If I had to think of all the couple of illnesses, certain illnesses I had as a baby, my neighbor's dog almost ripping me apart at 7, a fall that could have been so much different also at age 7 on a bicycle going down a steep tar road, a couple of car accidents I've had in my life, just to name a few things. I wouldn't even have been here if it wasn't for Him. So how can I walk around bragging on what I'm doing if I can't even stay alive without the Lord? You know, His breath is in us. We say that. If you stay quiet for a moment and you just really listen, you'll hear the in will be Yah and out will be where in your breath. God is in your breath. He breathed His life in you. He breathed His breath in you. So if I can't even be alive without God, how can I walk around bragging about doing stuff that, yes, He's given me skills and He's given us abilities and He's given us opportunities to do things. Of course. But He gave us that. He designed us this way. So all glory should really go to Him from the get-go. Oh, man. It's either Him that keeps us going. It's Him that gives us knowledge and wisdom and strength. Through Christ Jesus, I can do all things. Oh, this is hitting me harder now that I'm sharing it with you than I did when I was sitting putting all these couple of notes together over here. Oh, man. It's about knowing that it's not you. You were used because you made yourself available to Him. You were used because you opened yourself up to God and said, God, here am I, a living sacrifice for You. Use my eyes, use my mouth, use my mind, use my body, use my actions. Use me. Here I am. Use my feet. Let me go. You know, if humility wasn't a big thing or a key element for the Lord, it definitely wouldn't have been talked about in the Bible in so many scriptures. I thought I'd just have a quick quiz online just to see if I can get a general idea. I can't. I should actually see if somebody counted how many times the word humility or humble is mentioned in the Bible. I think I should do that because it's plenty. Just in Proverbs alone, I found 10 plus quickly. And just to give you a quick four, Proverbs 22 verse 4, by humility and fear of the Lord are riches and honor and life. Proverbs 11:2, when pride comes in, then shame comes, but with the humble is wisdom. Proverbs 18:12, before destruction the heart of a man is haughty, and before honor is humility. Proverbs 15:33, the fear of the Lord is the instruction of wisdom, and before honor is humility. There's just a quick four in Proverbs alone. And Solomon mentions humility great many more times throughout Proverbs, but right throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament, wherever you look, humility will be there. Even David wrote in, what did I read this morning? Was it 133? He says, don't let me be boastful. Let me be humble, Lord. Because that's how You've come to grow me. That's how You ended up giving me wisdom. And I think also an arrogant windgat, oh, you can't really teach them anything because they think they know everything. Humble people can learn so easily. And if I really think of that happening in my life without even realizing it at those stages, is that in humble moments, I learned a heck of a lot more than I'd learned in the boastful moments, you know. James 4:10 comes in and says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord and He will lift you up. And then 1 Peter 5, therefore humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Ugh. God will lift you up and elevate you and exalt you when the time is right, my friend, when the fruit is ripe. Don't rush things. It'll happen when it is time. In the end, it's not about letting people walk over you. No, there's a fine line between letting people walk over you and humility. There's a difference between the two as well, if you weren't aware of that. Humility is not letting people walk over you. It's about not bragging about stuff that you couldn't have done by yourself. We thank people when they praise us. We go, yes, thank you. But even I saw a oh man, a great guy, and I don't like throwing names around on my videos, but I saw a video of this very big entrepreneur which I think is from South Africa, yeah? And the first thing when somebody gave him praise, and he was on an interview on a radio station, a guy said, dude, I am where I am because I sat in one of the things where you spoke one day. And this guy turned around and he said, I wish I could take credit. But credit is due for the Lord. Credit belongs to the Lord. All glory and honor to the Lord. This hit me so hard about this guy. I couldn't believe it. It was absolutely beautiful to see. That's the thing that elevates you, my friends. If you know where your power is, if you build your foundation upon the rock, upon Jesus, and let him help you build that foundation, you will have the strongest foundation and you won't ever need to redo it ever again. Humility is knowing that because of the Lord, we're able to do the things that we do. Things we shouldn't have been able to accomplish. But we do it, we get it. We reach these things, we get those deals, we get things we never in life thought possible, but we reach there. Why? Because God elevated your humility. God grew your obedience and your sacrifice. All because of the Lord's favor over your life. The same way, however, to think about this, the same way that parents take things away when you're an ungrateful brat as a kid, remember that the same way God can do it too. We need to be punished, disciplined. Even Solomon writes about it. If you spare the rod, you condemn the child. It's important to realize this. We make mistakes sometimes. It happens. But I want you to take these opportunities, make humility such a big part of your life, my friend. It's about knowing God is number one in your life. He needs to be number one, and it's because of him that we're able to do and achieve and get to all these magnificent places and spaces that we desire to be at. Oh man, the Bible says, delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. So God will elevate you. He'll bring you to a place. But walk with him, step with him, and know that he is the provider of everything. The Bible says that the earth and everything in it belongs to the Lord. That includes you. That includes your goals. That includes etc., etc. So make humility one of the biggest parts of your life and just see what God is not only going to do in you and in your life, but also all around you, my friend. Open yourself up today and make yourself a living sacrifice for the Lord.